أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على مولانا نبي بعد سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome once again to the House of Dua, a platform that is designed for you and I to connect, to discuss, to understand the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as sent down through the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in this book known as Al-Quran. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, in our last presentations, we have made a central theme, and that theme was how to connect with our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and sent us down to this planet to worship Him. And He has promised that if we do so, He will give us a better place to live, known as Akhirah, where we will be happy forever. We realize that in addition to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as human beings, we face a great deal of difficulties in this planet. We have different challenges. Some people are not feeling well. Some people have no children. Some people have children, but they have difficulty in raising the children. Others have no means of sustaining their families. Marriages are unstable. Children who have graduated from school have no jobs. Just name it. We are in a world of trials and tribulations. Unfortunately, many of us go outside the fold of Islam to seek solution to these problems, either because they don't know what the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has provided for them in this book known as Al-Quran, or because they are misguided, they are misinformed by what they see other people do. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He created us, He also didn't leave us alone to wonder about. He sent down this book, Al-Quran, as a guidance for us in all that we do. And in this book, verse 2 of Surah Al-Baqarah, which is chapter 2 of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَٰلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This is a book, without doubt, it's a guidance for mankind. Guidance for you when you are sick. Guidance for you when you are hungry. Guidance for you when you are rich. Guidance for you when you are poor. Guidance for you when you are facing any kind of difficulty. And in this book also, it describes to us that this is a book of Shifa, a remedy, a solution to your problem. Why should we neglect this book? Why should we put it aside and start seeking solutions from other objects, from other institutions that themselves are creatures of the Creator? So in our last presentation, we have tried to remind you of the need to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a daily basis. Because in Islam, the understanding is that prevention is better than cure. When you are close to your Creator and you worship Him as He ought to be worshipped, and you do what He asks you to do, then of course, He understands you more than you understand yourself. He knows the problems. He knows the challenges. He knows your needs. He will also be able to provide for you even ahead of time. He will save you from those things that would have hurt you. That is why it's important for us to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We reminded you before that one of the ways to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through the reading of the Quran. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it compulsory, obligatory upon us that while we are worshipping Him, we should worship Him by also reading this Qur'an. That's why in our salat, we read the Qur'an. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the complaint we have from some of our listeners is that many of us are not able to read the Qur'an. If you cannot read the Qur'an, therefore, does it mean you cannot connect with your Creator? The answer is no. You can connect with your Creator. But I don't want you to put yourself in a position where you will say, I can't read the Qur'an. Yes, you can. You can read the Qur'an. Even right now, you cannot claim that you are unable to read the Qur'an if you are a Muslim. I'm not aware of any Muslim adult in this world who is unable to read Surah Al-Fatiha. If you are able to read Surah Al-Fatiha, you have the entire Qur'an. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in his hadith says, Surah Al-Fatiha is the condensation of the entire Qur'an. This is the most read book in the world, the Qur'an. Compared to any other book that other religions may have, there's no book that is as read and as memorized as this book known as Al-Qur'an. And you are part of those who read it. You are part of those who memorize it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that all of us will not be able to read this book. There are some who memorize the book. There are some who are just managing, who memorize a few verses or a few surahs. There are some who are struggling. At whatever level you are doing your best. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware He will reward you abundantly. That's why He made it clear in Surah Al-Muzammil. Fakra'u matayasara min al-Qur'an. That little one you can read in the Qur'an that is simple for you, read it. Make use of it. Believe in it. Apply it to your life. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, today we are going to remind ourselves of how to use this Qur'an to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The book I'm holding before you right now is available everywhere in this world. There's no portion of this planet in which this book is not available. Are you aware that in order to make this book accessible to every human being on this planet, verses and selected surahs of this book have been translated into 114 languages on this planet. And the entire Quran has been translated into over 50 different languages on this planet. So if you can't read the Arabic version of the Quran, therefore, you can read the version that is in your own language, which is going side by side with the Arabic language. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, therefore, we can all claim, we can say to the best of our ability that we are readers of the Quran, and we read it and we are following it. So don't count yourself out and say you cannot read the Quran, therefore you are not able to connect with your Creator. Even if you are having difficulty in reading the Quran, my question is, instead of claiming you cannot read the Quran, do you try? Do you make effort? If you are unable to read it at first attempt, don't be surprised. Knowledge comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He grants to whoever He wants to grant. All you need to do is to make effort and expect the favor from Allah that He will enhance it for you so that you'll be able to read it. Let me first of all go back to a few episodes in the past for you to be convinced that you are not alone in this difficulty. Remember when Jibreel alayhi salam came down to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa salam with the first revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What was that first revelation? Jibril told the Holy Prophet Muhammad, Iqra. What was the prophet's response? Ma'ana bikari. The Jibril said, read. And he said, I can't read. I'm not literate. Who is speaking to me and how can I can't read? Jibril alayhi salam repeated, Iqra bismi rabbika allazi khalaq. Khalaqal insana min 'alaq. Read in the name of your Lord who has created man from a clot of blood. Read. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, man abikari, I can't read. Then he came again, Iqra wa rabbuka li akram allazi 'allama bil kalam 'allama al insana ma lam ya'lam. Allahu akbar. Read in the name of your Lord, the most honored, the one who has taught writing by the pen, and the one who has taught man what he does not know. Read. Then the prophet began to read. What lesson do you derive from this? At first attempt, you may think it's impossible, but with Allah, you can make it. All you need to do is to make effort. Don't forget, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he stated in this verse, Allama al insana ma lam ya'lam. He has taught man what man didn't know before. You remember the case of Adam alayhi salam, when he was created, when he was about to be sent onto this planet. The angel said, oh, why? We are enough for you, ya Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa allama adam al asma kullaha thumma aradahum ala al malaika. Allah taught Adam the most beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the names of everything that will be in existence on this planet. He taught Adam. Adam didn't know anything before. You remember the response of the angels to this issue when Allah posed the question to them. If you think you are smart and you know enough, then tell me the same names, this name that I'm presenting here. What was their response? Subhanak la ilma lana illa ma lam tana innaka antal halimul hakim. They declare to Allah, ya Allah, glory be to you. We don't know anything except by what you teach us. So knowledge is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You remember the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam? As recorded in Surah An-Naml. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكَدْ أَتَيْنَا دَاوُدَ وَسُلَيْمَانَ عِلْمًا وَقَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي فَضَّلَنَا عَلَىٰ كَثِيرٍ مِّنْ عِبَادِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He said, we granted knowledge to Dawood and Sulaiman, his son, and both of them were grateful. And Sulaiman confirmed this to his people when it was his time to rule. When he became a prophet and became a king, he told his people, we have been granted knowledge, we have been taught knowledge of the birds. So what I'm trying to tell you, my dear brother and sister, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the possessor of knowledge. You only need to make efforts towards him and he will grant your desire. Don't sit down and say you can't read the Qur'an. Don't sit down and say you can't read the Qur'an. You remember also the encounter of Musa alayhi salam with Khidr alayhi salam, which is recorded in Surah Al-Kahf. Musa alayhi salam thought he was the most knowledgeable person of his time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't make that claim until you see a man known as Al-Khidr, who probably may have known more than you. Could there be a man on this planet that knows more than me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, of course there could be. Go in search of Khidr alayhi salam. You will find him at the meeting point of the two seas. Musa went on that expedition and finally met this man. I learned a lot from the man. At the end of the day, Musa alayhi salam concluded that truly he thought he was best in knowledge, but he has found that there was somebody more knowledgeable than him. Where did Khidr alayhi salam get that knowledge from? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلِمًا. We taught him the knowledge. The knowledge came from us. And he told the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam during his mission also, وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. We teach you what you don't know. And by that, that is a great deal of favor from us. So knowledge is a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's make effort to read it, to understand it, to use it to reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the essence of sending us this Quran. And he told Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, while you are learning to read and reading every day, وَكُمْ رَبِي زِدْنِي إِلَيْمًا. Always say, Ya Allah, increase me in knowledge. That's a powerful prayer for us. For you to say, I can't read the Quran, is a self-defeatist idea. What other book can you read besides the Quran? A book that has been sent down to you by your Creator as a remedy to your problems, as a guidance for your journey across this planet. I recommend it to you. Go on reading it. Try. Keep on trying. Aisha radiallahu anha, in the hadith that she narrated, said the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam says, those who memorize this Quran, they will be in Jannah with the angels of Allah. But those who are struggling and finding difficulty in the reading of this Quran, they will get double reward. Allahu Akbar. They will surely get double reward. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, how do we use the Quran to reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is the central point of my discussion this evening. You remember in our previous discussion, we mentioned to you that one day, Jibreel alayhi salam came down to visit Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And while they were sitting, there was a noise above. The sky cracked open and a big gate emerged and an angel descended. Jibreel said this was an angel of Allah coming down. That angel came to Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Muhammad, here is the gift of two lives that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked me to send them to you. These are two lights he never sent to anybody before you. What were those two lights? Surah Al-Fatiha and the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Great gifts. Now, when that revelation was coming down, the first that came down was Lillahi ma fi samawati wa ma fil ard. وَإِن تُبُدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ وَتُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبُكُم بِهِ اللَّهُ فَيَغْفِرُ لِمَن يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَن يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Allahu Akbar. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, to him belong everything that is in the planet, heaven and earth. Whatever you do or conceal in your heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you accountable for it. When this revelation came down and the Sahaba were informed, they were shaking to their foundation. They said, Ya Rasulallah, you have told us what to do, salat, zakat, Amalu Swaliha, we are doing our best. You mean what is inside our heart will be held accountable for it? How can that happen? How are we going to get Jannah? Can you request Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take that away from us? Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam told them, say, look, do not be like the people of the past. When commandments came from their creator to them, they said, Semina wa suena, we hear and we disobey. As a result of that, they were punished. As believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all you need to say is Semina watana. We hear and we obey. When you say that, leave the rest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not your duty to question the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They all accepted. Semina watana. Okay, we hear and we obey. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was so pleased with them that he embodied that in the next ayah and sent it to them. Amana rasulu bima unzila ilayhi min rabbihi wal mu'minun kullu amana billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusuli la nufariku baina ahadin min rusuli wa qalu sami'na wa ata'na ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was so pleased. He said, Rasulullah, the messenger, and the believers with him, they have declared that they believe in Allah, that they believe in the angels, they believe in the books, they believe in everything that Allah has sent down and his messengers. They don't discriminate between any of the messengers. This is the ayah of our iman, of our faith in our deen. Because of this, because they related back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala their complaints and their unease, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to remove that unease from them, decided to grant them relief by the next verse. La yukalifu lahu nafsan illa wus'aha laha ma kasabat wa 'alayha ma iktasabat. Allahu akbar. Up to the end of the verse. You know the verse more than me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because you have believed and accepted my commandment without question, then he now replaced the first verse with this verse. La yukalifu lahu nafsan illa wus'aha. No soul will be held accountable or will be burdened beyond the soul's capacity. Every soul, laha ma kasabat, if a soul does good, he will get the reward of it. Wa alayha ma iktasabat, when the soul does anything bad or evil, that soul will receive the punishment. So in other words, your action will determine what you receive. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what lesson do we learn from this? When you see the commandment from your Creator, when you are told that this is a commandment from your Creator, the verses of the Quran are asked to you, your immediate response should be, I obey, I concur, I accept. Thereafter, connect back to Allah and say, Ya Allah, I have this difficulty. Please make it easy for me. Because they return their feeling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the revelation, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them a relief. As you read the Quran yourself, have you seen commandments addressed to you? Do you respond back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? As we stated earlier in our presentation, the Quran is a medium of communication between you and your Creator. There is no better medium for you to relate with your Creator than the medium through which your Creator related with you. He has communicated to us through this Quran. It's our responsibility also to communicate back to him through the same medium. That's why he made it compulsory that we use it in our salawat. But do you communicate back to Allah yourself? If you read the Quran, there are many areas where Allah says, Ya ayyuha allazina amanu. Are you one of the lazina amanu? If so, do you answer that question? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling you, oh you who believe. Did you say, Na'am, ya Allah, I'm here? He gave commandment to Ibrahim alayhi salam to announce the Hajj to mankind so that every year they will come and perform the Hajj. So every year we make determination to go to Hajj. What are we doing? We are responding to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we say, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. So when you are reading the Quran and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling you, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, do you respond? as the Sahaba responded in this verse that I'm rehearsing to you. Several verses of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Akimu salata wa atu zakah. Render salah and render zakah. Allahu Akbar Kabir. What do you respond? What do you say when you get there? You should be able to say, Semina wa ata. Yes, I will do so, Ya Allah. And I have been doing so, and I will continue to do so. But as I do so, Ya Allah, make life easy for me. Make my children good. Give me opportunities in life. There's nothing wrong with that. That's why Allah says, well, the salat is a way of reaching out to Him. What's the end of the subject? What's salat? Seek from Allah with salat and patience. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, consider Surah Duha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alam yajidika yatima fawa wa wajadaka dola fahada wa wajadaka aila fahagina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Alam yajidika yatima fawa. Did we not meet you an orphan and we accommodated you, we housed you, we gave you asylum? It was addressing the prophet, but also addressing you. Can't you look back in life and look at a time when you were so weak, unable to take care of yourself, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made life easy for you, gave you a fortress? Was there no time in life when you were not sure where to go, whether to go to school, whether to go to market or whatever? Whom are you going to marry? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Fahada, we guided you. Was there no time when you were so poor, you couldn't have 3 square meals a day? Today you are a big man, a millionaire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, didn't we make you a poor person, and yet, Fahagina, we made you rich? When you get to these verses, what do you say? Na'am, Ya Allah, you did. And for that reason, I will worship you more. And because I'm striving to worship you, please make it easy for me. This is how to use the Quran to reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we are reading the Quran, we read it, we don't pay attention, we don't slow down. In Surah Al-Muzammil again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Waratil al-Quran tartila. Read the Quran in measured rhythm, in measured tone. Let it be beautiful. Why? So that you have time to pause and listen to what you have been told and respond. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was doing that all the time. Let's go back to Surah Al-Hujurat. In that surah, one of the most beautiful surahs of the Quran, surah of peace of mind, surah of harmony in the society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Wa'alamu anna fikum rasulallah. La yuti'ukum fi kathirin minan amrin la nitum. Walakinna allaha habba ilaykum al-iman wa zayyanahu fi qulubikum wa karaha ilaykum al-kufra wal fusuqa wal 'isyan ulaika humur rashidun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if the prophet were to follow you people in your self-desires, in everything that you want to do, if he were not to listen to the commandments of Allah, of course all of you will find yourself in difficulty. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the faith so endeared to you. He has prevented you from fusuk. You know what the meaning of fusuk? Transgression. What is yan? Rebelliousness. He has prevented all that from you and guided you to faith. And those who are so guided, these are the ones who are Rashidun. Those who are on the right path. Aisha radiallahu anha, in hadith that she narrated, similar hadiths were narrated by other narrators, Aisha confirmed that whenever the prophet came to this verse in Surah Al-Hujurat, he will pause. Then he will say, Allahumma abibu ilayna al-imana wa zayyinhu fi qulubina wa karih ilayna al-kufra wa al-fusuqa wa al-isyan wa ja'alna min ar-rashidin. Why did the prophet do that? And why can't you do that? Because the Prophet realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is communicating with him. He needs to communicate back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the medium of communication. That's what the Quran is all about. Aisha again, radiallahu anha, the wife of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, confirmed that whenever the Prophet came to verses in the Quran that spoke about hell or fire or punishment or the anger of Allah, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would pause and say, Ya Allah, save us from your punishment. Ya Allah, save us from your naru jahannam. Ya Allah, make life easy for us. And whenever he came to areas where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about Jannah, happiness, everlasting good life, the Prophet would pause and say, Ya Allah, grant us Jannah. Ya Allah, have mercy on us in this world. Ya Allah, make our return to you a better return. That's the messenger of Allah. That's the one we are following. Are you doing the same thing? You are simply saying you cannot read the Quran, but you can read Surah Al-Fatiha. You can read Surah Al-Fatiha.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Did you pause there to say, Ya Allah, in your name, the only one, no child, no partner, nothing like you. In your name I start.
Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin.
All the praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fishes in the ocean praise him. Trees in the bush praise him. Birds in the air praise him. Animals praise him. The jinns praise him. And I join them in praising you, Ya Allah. Therefore accept my praise. But Ya Allah, I have this difficulty. I'm not well. Or my child is sick. Or I need money. Whatever you need, add it to it. You are communicating with your Creator. It's permissible. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us not just rest and say we can't read the Quran. And those of us who read it, let's not abuse the Quran by refusing or failing to use the Quran as a medium of communication between you and your Creator. Because the problems that are pressing you down, there are solutions for them. The solution is you reaching out to your Creator who created you, who knows about these problems. My dear brothers and sisters, now that we know that the Quran is a medium of communication between us and our Creator, I also need to remind you that this is a virtue that we must not allow to go unutilized. Let me take you back to Surah Zaza, for example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَّهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَّهُ. Whoever does good, he will receive the reward. Whoever does evil, he will get the punishment. Now, let me take you back to a very famous hadith known as the Hadith of the Cave, narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, in which the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, in the generations that came before us, there were three people that went on a journey. At the time it was raining, they decided to seek refuge in a cave. While they were inside that cave, a big boulder fell down from the top and covered the entrance to that cave. So they were locked in. They had no way of going out. So their problem now was, how do we get out of this place after the rain? One of them said, no one can take us out of this cave except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we are going to do is to plead with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the goodness that we have done in the past, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us relief. So one of them decided to start. Say, Ya Allah, I'm your servant. I had a laborer before. He worked for me. I was supposed to pay him a basin of rice. But he did not wait to receive his payment, so he left. I was wondering how to get him to pay him. I waited, he didn't come. So what I did was to go and replant that rice. I harvested it. They did so well. I sold it. The money I got from it, I used it to buy cows. I wasn't sure whether the boy who worked for me was going to return. So, but one day he came. He said, "Where is my payment?" I said, "Go to the garden there. There are cows grazing in the garden. Those are your payments." He said, "No, you were supposed to pay me a basin of rice." He said, "Yes. When you left, I had to replant the rice, and the rice did so well, I sold them, I used them to buy the cows. So these cows are for you. That's the product of your labor. That's the payment you deserve." So the laborer was so pleased. Then the man told Allah, "Ya Allah, I did this for your sake. Because of that, I plead with you to ask this rock to move away from the entrance of this cave so that we can come out." So the rock shifted a little bit. The second man said, "Ya Allah, I had parents. They were old. I was bringing milk to them as their dinner. So, but one day I came late. I found that they were already asleep. So I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to wake them because you told us to honor our parents. I didn't want to wake them up. Neither do I want them to sleep with empty stomach. So I stood by the door hoping that they would wake up. They never woke up until daybreak. Ya Allah, I did that because of your commandment that we should honor our parents. As a result of that good deed, please make this rock move a little bit for us to get out." The rock again shifted. They were now able to see the light of the day. But the space was not enough for them to get out. Then the third person said, "Ya Allah, I had a cousin, the daughter of my uncle, very beautiful. I tried to approach her to make love with her. She asked me to give her 100 dinar, that is, pieces of gold. I went and looked for it and gave to her. Just as we were about to do the act, I was about to make love with her, she told me, 'Fear Allah, don't disflower me. Out of your fear, Ya Allah, I refuse to do the act. Therefore, because of that, let this rock move away from this entrance to this cave so that we can go out.' The rock finally moved away and they got out." What does that tell you? This is to teach us that the good deeds we carried out because of Allah, we can use them as a basis to call on Allah. Say, "Ya Allah, I was very good to my parents. I did this for my parents because of you. Therefore, make my life easy." It also reminds us that whatever we do it for the sake of Allah. It's an act of worship. And in an act of worship, you can communicate back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means. So while you are reading the Quran, either in Salat or as just a leisure reading, whatever, at your pastime, you are reading it for what? Just because Allah asks you to read it, it becomes an act of worship. That's why Allah says reading the Quran is rewardable. While you are reading it, therefore, you come to an area where Allah talks about goodness, ask for goodness. When he talks about punishment, seek refuge in him against that punishment. When he talks about certain virtues, ask for those virtues. This is how to use the Quran to reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, let us not rest on our oars. Again, we have come to you today to remind you on the importance of connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially connecting with him with the Holy Quran. It's a book that is like no other book. It has solution to our problems. To go outside the fold of Islam or to go outside the Quran to seek solutions from objects, from human beings, from those things that associate partnership with Allah is a wrong and woeful path. Therefore, let's not go along that path. Let's return back to the Quran and seek solution to our problems as prescribed for us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our sustainer, our provider, our curer, the one to whom we shall return after our stay on this planet. I ask Allah to make your life easy and to make my life easy. I ask Allah to bless all of us and take Shaitan away from our life and take our life far away from the Shaitan. Rabbana tabamina. Innaka anta sami'un alim wa tubu alayna ya maulana. Innaka anta ghafurur karim. Ya Allah, if we have made a mistake in this presentation, forgive us, and if we have done it right, give us the reward in this world and in the akhirah, ya Allah. We thank you for your abundance. We thank you for your protection. We thank you for your sustenance. We look forward to meeting you on the day of Qiyam. We ask you to make our life in this world good and to make our return to you better, inshallah. Ya Allah, we thank you for making us Muslim, making us followers of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Unite us with him on the day of judgment in Jannah al-Firdaus, ya Allah. May Allah make our life easy for us. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasan, wa fi akhirati hasan, wa qina azaban. Rabbana la tu'akhizna in nasina aw akhtana. Rabbana wa la tahmilna alayna isra kama hamaltahu ala allazina min qablina. Rabbana wa la tu'amilna ma la taqata lana bi. وعفو عنا وغفر لنا وارحمنا انت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك